Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Everyone this evening, before we start our meeting, Commissioner Eddie Boswell will offer an invocation followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. Eddie?
Let's all bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings you give us and for all of the things you do for us. And dear Heavenly Father, be with the folks this past week that have had devastation in their lives, the tornadoes and all the hardships across this country. Just be with them and comfort them today. And dear God, just help us as a board to make the right decisions for this county and to lead this county into a better place. And with your help, I know we can do that. These things we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
Now let's face
it. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Be careful. I'm not. Thank you, Eddie. First item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. I'd like for commissioners to review the agenda, also the consent agenda. At this time, if there are any items that any commissioner requests to be removed from the consent agenda, let's talk about that, and then we'll approve the agenda in its entirety. Are there any items that we need to take off the consent agenda?
Go ahead, Tim.
Yeah. Would like three C, please.
Okay, both. There are two items under three C.
Yeah,
both
I know there was three. Two. Of course, they're part of the same item. Just take both.
Okay.
We'll discuss about that.
Let's do that. And with the board's permission, we will insert that after the online permitting update, which is item number 8. Is that all right with everyone? Hearing no objections, is there a motion then with that exception to approve the agenda as presented to include the remaining part of the consent agenda?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Eddie. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. This time we'll have public comment. Welcome to all of you. If you are here to speak at the public hearing on the proposed ordinance revision, we will have a public hearing in just a few minutes. This comment period is for public speakers who wish to take up to 3 minutes and talk about whatever they want to. So if you didn't sign the list that I have and you want to talk or listen to the public hearing, that's right. That's correct. If you are here and did not get a chance to sign up for public comment and do not want to talk about what we'll be talking about in the public hearing, then you need to let Sherry know. So I have one, Mr. Eddie Hsu, if you'd like to come forward, and we're going to, what are we going to discuss tonight?
Hey, Mr. Chairman, I'll be brief because it's kind of futile. I know that this money that's coming under number 7, budget minimum 108, I know that's their money, but I feel like they could use it for something else. Here I've got a simple diagram of how most of the world does what they're talking about. It's called point-to-point connection. You don't need a cable. You don't got to pay nobody. You just take your set of, you get a set of keys on your computer. Once you set up, you click, and you're on whatever computer they allow you on down there, social services or wherever they're hooking up. It's their money. I guess they can, if that's a cable, $65,000 cable is what they're going to spend it on. But I would certainly keep it in mind if they ever come back and want some tax money, because there's a whole lot of cheap ways to do it, and the one they're picking, there ain't but a couple that's higher. And that's basically all I want to say. If you want to pass that around, you can. But that's basically how the rest of the world does it. And it's kind of a little funny on the call and back. Appreciate your time.
Katie, thank you. We actually have representatives from social services, I think, in the other room. We make sure that they get this information.
911, I think.
It is
part of the 911 part.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay. We'll make sure they get that information. That's all the public comments. Commissioners' responses, I just have a couple of things to start. I want everybody to recognize and welcome our chair member, Linda Massey. She's back from successful knee surgery. So if you see her go slowly or push you away, that's why. But we welcome you back, and that was good because you were here last time and you're here this time. So that's wonderful. The second thing, for those that did not see it, we have another board member who has other skills as being February's Cook of the Month, full halftime page above the spread, above the fold. So congratulations to Eddie, and we expect next month for you to have for us shrimp and grits with a splash of wine and all the fixings. So that's great. And then the third thing I have, we've been invited by or encouraged by the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners to schedule a meeting or a lunch meeting with our three state folks that go to Raleigh, our two legislators and our senator, which would be Alice Bordston, Dan Engel, and Rick Gunn. And there are three issues that the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners have identified as being kind of top priorities for this. This is a short session, and one has to do with the upcoming state budget. They approved the budget for a two-year cycle, so that'll involve just some tweaking during this short session. That's one issue. The second issue is to allow the local counties, our counties, to have some flexibility in how social services is formed and structured and developed. We probably need to learn a little bit about that. And then the third is to authorize counties to enter into broadband public-private partnerships to serve those parts of the county that currently don't have it, and it may not be justified totally to be funded by the county, but to perhaps allow for the formation of partnerships. So I guess I need a feel if this is something that the board wants to pursue. Would it be a good idea, or is it something we want to pass on? Anybody have any thoughts?
I think it would be a good idea. I know, I just think about the broadband issue. I was talking to a gentleman in the southern part of the county that all they can get right now is a dial-up, and you know, he was having issues. So I think that is something for the people in our county that would have an interest in us maybe looking at helping them to get some kind of service out there. I know that's one thing, and of course state budget is very important to us. So, if we can do that, I think it'd be great.
Yeah, anytime we can communicate with those people and find out more information, we need to do it.
Okay. Any other sentiments?
Maybe pass along what we think along with those people. So we've got to make those decisions.
Well, and to get them on our turf is not only easier, but gives us the home court advantage sometimes. Any objection then to pursuing that meeting?
Set a date.
Well, what I was hoping is that I could give this to Craig, and maybe Craig and Tori can compare calendars with them. The short session doesn't start till May, so we've got basically half of March and all of April to schedule something like that. So I'll give you this information after and let you guys see what we can work out.
Well, do you want to try to do it? If we pick a time that may help around the lunch, would that be more equitable for everybody to do it?
I'm okay with that.
You'll be fine with me.
Okay.
How about you, Tim?
I don't really care. Whatever the majority wants to do.
I don't care.
Is that enough? Ammunition, Craig?
Yes, sir.
All right, I'll make sure you get this after. Other commissioner comments at this time?
Now, we're still going to have our commissioner comments at the end of the meeting.
Right.
Okay, I'll wait
till then. Okay, thank you. We will now, yes.
I would like to thank the county for my flowers that they sent me. So if you'll pass that on, they were really nice. But just don't hit my knee. I still got stitches. So that's all I got to say.
Linda, we're just glad you're better.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. The next item is the public hearing on the subdivision ordinance. And what I think we would like to proceed on the basis of is to have Jason Martin, who's our planning director, come and present some revisions that have been proposed by the planning board. We have members of the planning board here. Last time the policy was presented, we had two public comments in this meeting, and then we also had a gentleman, I think Jason met with you, that you may want to cover on some ideas to consider. Subsequent to that meeting, the planning board did meet and actually, I think, has some changes that they would like to present. And so after talking to our attorney, we can actually hear the revisions proposed and then go right into the public hearing. And we certainly won't take a vote or have discussion as a board until after that public hearing. During the public hearing, you are not limited to our 3 minutes that we normally have for public comment, but we would ask you to kind of stay on topic and tell us what you're feeling and what you're hearing, and we'll go from there. So if that's all right with everyone, I'll now call on Jason to present this revised ordinance at this time. Welcome, Jason. Glad you're feeling better.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, good evening. Before I start, I will just go ahead and recognize the planning board members that are here this evening. Chairman Bill Griffith is here, Vice Chairman Ray Cobb, Todd Lambert, who is a member on the commission, Jennifer Cranford, she's right here, and Eric Richardson as well. So you should have a memorandum in your packet outlining the proposed revisions. As Chairman Manning was referring to, I did originally do a presentation for the board, a PowerPoint and all, of some original proposed amendments to the subdivision ordinance that dealt with private roads as well as a few other items. Initially, there's two classifications of private roads in Alamance County, Class 1 and Class 2. And initially, the planning board had recommended to basically do away with the Class 1 private road and cap subdivisions or dividing of lots to 8 lots on a private road and everything being built to Class 2 standards. Of course, at the evening that I was not here, I know there were a few folks that spoke that evening, and I did get a chance to go back and look at the video of that and also to speak with Mr. Hsu and Mr. Hargrove both by telephone, as well as Mr. Holt, who came into the office and met with me for a little while after I came back to work. And all of them expressed very similar concerns with the elimination of Class 1 private roads and the effect that that would have on smaller developers and particularly on farmers and family subdivisions where there's large tracts of land off of a state-maintained road and they may be using an existing driveway or something like that and want to be able to cut off a lot or two lots for family members. Under the original proposal, that would have required a construction of a Class 2 private road, an 18-foot travelway, basically state DOT specs without the road being paved. And the cost that would be incurred with that was at the heart of their concern. So after speaking with Chairman Griffith, we did decide to go ahead and call a special meeting of the planning board to reconsider those recommendations. And so you have in your packet tonight the proposed recommendation now, which was recommended unanimously by the planning board on February 23rd. And so I will briefly summarize that.
Christian, let me ask you,
yes, sir.
Some people probably have seen this online. Before you go into it, can you tell us kind of the rules? Because we have yellow highlights and then we have crossed out sections.
Absolutely.
So tell us kind of what we're looking at.
Yes, sir. I'll be glad to. Section 62, streets and roads, the 62.9, this is not existing. This is a new piece of language here that's highlighted in yellow, which states road access, all lots with frontage on an interior road shall be required to access from the interior road. This is a standard that we request now at the technical review level when we have a new subdivision come in. And this is where you have a new subdivision road coming off of a state road or off of another subdivision road. So it limits the number of driveway cuts where they're not lined together. Instead of having 3 access points, have 1 access point that's used. And it's purely, most of this is purely public safety. Also, Section 64, that's highlighted in yellow there, private roads, I'll just read the section. This is the language as it stands now. Private roads may be allowed in any development in which a tract of land is divided into no more than 14 parcels. And the recommended change here is to change that to 8 parcels. And that is based in the land development plan. The Alamance County Land Development Plan currently recommends 6 lots. The planning board actually felt that that was too restrictive, and they came to the conclusion that 8 lots would be the better choice. So be divided into no more than 8 parcels is how it would read, along the private road, and each parcel shall not be less than 1 acre in size, provided that the following conditions are met. And the next section, 64.17, private roads shall be visually inspected by the subdivision administrator before final plat approval. This is existing language. The visual inspection is to ensure that general compliance with the private road standards have been met. And the planning board has recommended adding an additional statement here that is highlighted in yellow that says, a certification of compliance from a professional engineer that contains the signature and seal of the engineer may be accepted in lieu of a visual inspection. A copy of the proposed road maintenance agreement shall be submitted to the planning department prior to recordation of any plats. And that is just to add an option there. We currently will accept certifications from engineers. It's an option. It's, again, just kind of putting into writing something that we already allow and making it clear that this is allowed. Also, this requiring the submission of a road maintenance agreement to be filed with our office is for the purpose behind that is that when a new private road is constructed, there is some form of road maintenance put into place, some type of an agreement between the property owners as to who will maintain it and how it will be divvied up. What happens, or what we have found in our office, is that years down the line, we will receive phone calls from folks saying, we have a pothole in the road. When is the county going to come out and maintain it, or come out and fix the pothole? And, of course, it's a private road. The county doesn't do road maintenance even on public roads. But by having that information, we can then assist them and say, when this subdivision was done, there was a road maintenance agreement put into place. It can be found at, you know, such and such book and page, and here's what that maintenance agreement says, provided that they haven't made any changes to it over time. Again, just allows us to assist citizens more with their questions. Classes of private roads, 64.2. The standards and specifications for private roads depends on the number of lots served by the road as follows. Again, that is language that currently exists. Class 1, 1 to 4 lots. And that is the current standard that we have. And then now Class 2 would say 5 to 8
Jason,
lots.
Jason, at Standard 1, what is that a 10-foot
right away? It is. Yes, sir. It's a 10-foot road with a 50-foot right-of-way.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Let me ask a question on that, because I was asked earlier this evening. If we maintain that 10 feet, is there any requirement of compaction or anything other than just the owner being clearing the way?
Right. There is a requirement in the depth of the gravel that has to be put in. I believe it is 4 inches of compacted gravel.
And we're not suggesting to modify that.
We'll keep it exactly the same as is currently in the ordinance. The planning board has also recommended adding an additional statement on plats that use private roads. Subdivisions utilizing private roads other than those built to Class 2 standards shall be required to record the following note on the plat. Lots on blank road are served by a class blank private road that does not meet the standards established by NCDOT and or NC Fire Code and may require future upgrades prior to consideration for maintenance by a public agency. And again, that's just to make it clear, this is a private road. It is not maintained by the county or by the state. And that in order for the state to take it over, it may have to be upgraded at some point. And again, just that we're doing our due diligence on the front end to be transparent with folks when they subdivide. The next section here, 64.21, Class 1 private roads intended to serve 2 or fewer new lots are not required to be constructed to Alamance County standards or to be inspected before recordation of the final plat. Now, the planning board's recommendation is to strike out the language referring to inspections. That basically that this would need to be visually verified that there is something in place. Again, this is the driveway that's being used. Somebody wants to put a 50-foot right-of-way around the driveway. May not necessarily be a 10-foot travel way, but they want to still be able to cut out a couple of lots. The planning department would go out and inspect and make sure that the road is there. Basically, I hate to use the term inspect, but to visually verify that the road is there. And the purpose behind that is if somebody cuts out a lot and is going to build a house on it, if there's an accident on the site, we need to be able to get an ambulance to them. Or if there's a fire, we need to be able to get a fire truck to them. So we need to verify that there is something there for public safety. Alamance County does recommend that these Class 1 roads be built to these standards in order to provide adequate access, especially for emergency vehicles. Again, that's existing language that's already in the ordinance. Section 64.6, subdivisions accessed by nonconforming private roads shall require a waiver as specified in Section 34 of this ordinance. Now, currently, there's four other subsections there underneath that where nonconforming private roads can be used as long as there's 60 feet of road frontage on the road and that then an original tract of land adjoining a nonconforming private road may be divided utilizing the provision only once every 2 years and that a private road disclosure statement be recorded and that all other provisions of the ordinance be met as well. This would take out that restriction of a lot being able to be cut out once every 2 years into perpetuity. It would require a waiver, and the purpose behind the planning board's recommendation on that is that if, again, the nonconforming private road. It is a road that can be identified on an aerial from 1974 or was platted or was proof that it was in existence before the subdivision ordinance was approved. By requiring a waiver, the property owner would need to be able to verify that the road is being maintained in such a standard that, again, emergency vehicles can get to it. One example that I gave in the presentation that night, which was about a half a mile road, at the back of it there were five lots cut out. That is a non-conforming private road. That's an actual example of one in the county. And the fire marshal and I tried to drive that road. We did make it to the top of it with a little bit of luck and four-wheel drive. We did make it there. But that is a good example of a road that probably need to look at the maintenance of it before another lot is allowed to be subdivided. One point I would make is with the waiver, the way the ordinance is currently written, you can cut out a lot once every 2 years. One property owner can do that every 2 years. If the property owner next to them wants to do it within 2 years, they can't do it. It's kind of pigeonholed them to where they can't. With this provision, both property owners would be able to do it. They would just have to request a waiver.
Let me ask you something.
Yes, sir.
What business does the fire marshal have to do with roads?
Just to ensure that something can get to the back of it.
The answer should be nothing. They should not be involved in roads. The only thing they should be involved in is fire safety. That's my opinion. And if they're doing more than what they should be doing, it's a violation to our citizens of this county.
Moving forward to Section 66.3, double frontage and reverse frontage. Double frontage lots and reverse frontage lots shall be avoided is the current language, and we're recommending to change that to prohibited, except where required to separate development from through traffic on arterial and major streets or to separate residential development from non-residential development. And again, that's the only change, is the change from avoided to prohibited in the language there. Section 66.12, this is referring to exclusive access easements, which are required to be at least 25 feet wide, 300 feet long. There is currently a restriction on the use of exclusive access easements that they can only be used once on an original tract of land. Issue there being you may run into lots that are 30, 40, 50 acres in size, and you can easily get 150-foot spacing between two easements. This would actually allow folks to be able to use more than one exclusive access easement to cut out a new lot. So it's just giving another option for somebody to build a driveway back to a lot is the purpose behind that. And then a new section here, 66.14, flag lots. Flag lots shall not be permitted along state highways. All flag lots shall maintain a minimum width of 60 feet within the flag pole portion of the lot as specified in the ordinance. And the recommendation to prohibit flag lots along state highways is actually a recommendation, again, out of the land development plan. And then also at the back, there is a...
Jason, wait, before you leave, can you, for everybody here, I was not familiar with that term.
Oh, okay.
Can you, in your, with your fingers, kind of draw, turn around and draw what a flag lot is?
I'll be glad to. I'll kind of share this just on a piece of paper here.
That was one of those things he showed in the video a couple weeks ago.
And I'm glad he did. I thought it was a lot where you could
put a flag.
Well, it is.
It definitely is.
Yeah. And this is kind of what we're referring to here.
Yeah, if you can kind of circle that. If anybody would like to see that more closely, just raise your hand.
And the long stem being the flagpole that opens up into the lot. All of this being part of the same lot.
But the minimum is up there on the main highway,
on the main road,
where you're coming off of the main road.
Exactly, and that's to allow somebody to build a driveway and to get back to a home site that's back off of the road.
Thank you.
Sure.
Would you repeat what you said as far as what you're proposing to change on that ordinance?
For the flag lot portion?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. What has been proposed is to prohibit the use of that along state highways because of the amount of traffic that goes on a state highway. Something like an 87, 54 would be to, again, they recommend prohibiting that. And then the other change is to require that in the flag pole that it stay 60 feet at least going back, as opposed to starting at 60 feet, dropping down to 20 feet, and then going back. And then in some cases, you'll see where there's lots that have been stripped back by doing that and dropping it back into a narrower flagpole and going back. And then you have a situation where you have multiple driveways that pile in on top of one another. That's the purpose behind that.
That was a 25-foot right-of-way before we changed it to a 60, is that right?
No, it wasn't. That's still the minimum road frontage is 60 feet. That's currently the standard. It's just now, the way the ordinance is written, somebody can take that flagpole and do, I'll draw another example here.
Like an hourglass out of it.
Mm-hmm. Right. And come back and do something kind of like that.
Let's see.
Yeah.
Well, and I think you need to
come
around again.
Sit in there and leave. Keeping it straight back, it narrows down right off the road.
But you prohibit them flat out on state roads?
Not state roads, on state highways. Like I said, 54, 49, 87, 62.
You mean state
119,
waters.
Right. The arterial roads.
So if you got 50 acres back off 54 or something and won't build a house, you can't do it. You can get the vegetable.
Oh, you can still do an easement back to it. Still allow an exclusive access easement, or if you have an existing driveway back there, you could do the class one private road with a 50-foot right of way. There's still options.
What is the purpose of this?
Let me ask Jason to complete his presentation, and then we'll open the public hearing for questions and comments, if that's all right. Just sit tight. We're almost there.
Okay.
But hold that thought.
Okay, and also in the back of the packet, the statement of plan consistency, and it's the formal recommendation from the planning board recommending approval of the proposed amendments along with the sections of the land development plan that correspond with it.
Okay.
And the purpose, the official purpose in the statement of plan consistency that the planning board found that the amendments are necessary, one, to ensure health, safety, and general welfare of the citizens of Alamance County, two, to ensure adequate access for law enforcement, fire, ambulance, and other emergency vehicles, and three, to promote the use of sound planning practices to encourage safe and efficient circulation of traffic on private and state-maintained roads. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions from the board at this time, and also my the members of the planning board are here to answer questions as well from the board.
Before we go into the public hearing, are there questions from board members?
Not at the present. I'd like to hear some comments.
After? Okay. All right, Jason, thank you. We'll now open the public hearing. The purpose of the public hearing is to hear from you, like your reactions, your thoughts, your feedback. It's not really a the public hearing is not for necessarily a debate. However, if there are questions that Jason can clarify or members of the planning board, I think we should certainly encourage that so that you all will have all the information that you need. So with that said, let me open the public hearing and just no particular order, we'll ask and invite anybody in the second row. Would you like to come forward? We're the third row. Henry? Welcome, Henry. Please identify yourself to everyone.
Yes, sir. My name is Henry Vines, and I live at 3450 Isley Drive in Snow Camp. Commissioners, I want to speak to United on this road ordinance, and because it directly affects me and a private road that runs parallel to my farm. First of all, I'd like to just ask each and one of you, as we go through this and listen to the comments that will be made tonight, that you look at this in an open mind, because what you're proposing is there is changes. This is not the same. It's clearly a lot of changes being made that are going to affect a lot of folks. Let me get my notes out here. First of all, I'd just like to go down what the changes they're saying is, and that they don't seem to think that these have any effects. First of all, on the first one, all lots that fronts are entering into a road shall be required to access into the interior road. Does that mean that we have to have one lot to each access? That's a question, you know, I'd like to know. The other thing is the moving from 14 lots down to 8. I don't see where that makes any difference. I don't see how that's anything to do with, you know, public safety. I will tell you that this adversely affects me personally and the people that live. I'm here tonight representing myself and along with other 10 other people that live on Country Lane. This right-of-way runs parallel to my farm, approximately 3/4 of a mile. There's currently 8 houses and 2 building lots already on this road. These are a 30-foot road right away. This is not a 50-foot right away. This road was established before 1982, before this original ordinance was established. Since then, I had this side of the road. I owned the whole side of this road on this side of the right away. Two other farmers on the other side. One farmer decided that he wanted to move to the city and has cut off several lots on the other side. I come before this board some 12 years ago, and Tim, you were here, and Bill, you were here, when it was asked for a waiver from this gentleman and to be able to sell more lots off of it. And at that time, I said, I don't care how many lots he sells off of it, just as long as when I get ready to cut them off on my side, that I'm allowed to do so, because I have kids and I have grandkids. And furthermore, I built the road. You know, when I went out there, there was no road. I built the road, and the other gentleman took advantage of the road and sold off lots. There's other lots been sold off that does not have any building lots. These people won't even have the option of even putting one lot on that road, because if this is moved back to 8, then we're already past the limit. There's no, that I know of, there's no talk of any kind of grandfathering or anything in these revisions that they're proposing here. So this is definitely going to have an impact, not only to me, but other people in this county are sitting in the same position. We have folks that have what you call class one roads that already have five dwellings on that road. It's a private road. It's a driveway that leads to these individuals' houses. I think that the ordinance that we had is restrictive enough. In fact, as in 1982, I was here too. I thought this was too restrictive then, but I understood. And the other thing that's been mentioned here, the reason that we're asking for these things is for public safety. None of these changes in here addresses public safety. I don't care if you got a 60-foot road all the way through. If that road is not maintained and taken care of, a emergency vehicle's still not going to get down it, Bill.
That's for sure.
If it's a hole in there and you fall in and turn over, it don't make no difference what it, you know. You know, that goes back to the responsibility of the landowners, mm-hmm. and it should stay that way. These are private roads. I think that this deters, private families the right to go in on their farms and cut off land for their kids and what have you. We certainly, each and every one, if you know that road is not up to standards, that if you have a heart attack and they can't get there to you, or if your house is on fire and they can't get to you, it's your fault. I heard one comment, you know, in the last meeting that was, you know, concerned of a liability to the county. Well, I don't see how that it could be any liability to the county if it's negligence on the homeowners for not keeping a road that he can get, be accessed to. There is no, that I've seen in here, who's going to enforce this? Is the county going to enforce these new rules? Or if the roads don't come to compliance, are y'all willing to take these roads over and let the county maintain them and keep them up? I see nothing in there that addresses this. Let's see here. I got that. Another thing that I don't understand here, too, that I want to be clear. It's like an existing road that I'm on a 30-foot right-of-way. There's a farm on this side, and I'm on the other side. It says it's going to have to be brought up to compliance. Is it going to have to be an additional 20-foot or 30-foot added to that, to that road, to bring that up to standards so that that it will stay in compliance with eight parcels? You're going to eliminate two of those? None of these things have been mentioned. I think commissioners, our planning board works to do a good job, and I don't quite understand why they brought this forward. I think they should have talked about this and discussed this a little bit further. We've had other ordinances come before this county, and I think this is only another effort in trying to zone the county by way of ordinances. If this county wants a countywide zoning ordinance, then I think that's what they should go after instead of trying to push these things behind our back. This 1982 deal was the same thing. It got passed, and nobody realized what was going on until it was too late. So I urge you not to make these changes. Our current policy is certainly strong enough and adequate enough to do what needs to be done in this county. And I would say that if the county wants to look at a way for public safety, that you could certainly up here on 64-17. Why couldn't the county have the inspector to go out and look at these private roads, and if these private roads are not up to standards as to for a vehicle to come through, then issue a letter to them and notify them that your road is unpassable and you may not receive emergency service. And if this doesn't bring them up to attention, I don't know what will. And as far as a maintenance plan, currently on people that's on our road, have to sign agreement with the finance companies, the lending institutions, saying that they will keep and maintain the road. So the lending part of this thing is governing a lot of it. And, you know, we want private and let private industry and private things drive these things. I think this should be done. And I appreciate the time, and I just hope that y'all will really look at this, because I really don't think that there are any changes need to be made. I think that these are way too restrictive, more than what we need. If you, as commissioners and the planning board, wants to require a 60-foot right-of-way for all roads in Alamance County so that the state can take them over and the tax dollars can keep them up, then that's what we need to do. But we cannot abandon the roads that's there and try to eliminate them in this ordinance. Thank you.
I agree with you 100%. I don't agree with you on many things, but I do on this.
Thank you, Henry. Other members of our audience tonight from the road that Henry's on?
Come please. On, Larry.
Welcome, sir. Welcome back.
Thank you. I appreciate y'all having me back. My name's Harold Hargrove, and I appreciate the work that the planning department has done and what they did try to accomplish here. But I couldn't say it any better than what Henry's just said it. There's no need for me to sit here and waste my time and your time. It's the point's been made that we're losing our rights as citizens. We have to put our seat belts on. I've got code books that are this thick where they were that thick building houses from 1982. But we need to leave these things alone so people can build on these family properties. Leave this 14 house minimum on here, because that if you're going to have a state specified road, then it's big enough to handle 14 houses. It's big enough to handle any of the houses, number of houses you want to put on it, because everybody in here drove on one of those roads to get here tonight. The state maintenance road, maintained road, except it's paid and what not paid. But that's my opinion on this, and I know the planning department worked hard, and I come to that meeting, I talk with them, and they accepted me very well, and I know I was strong on some of the stuff I said, but I just want to back up everything that Henry said, and I think that's what y'all should look at very strongly, too, and consider. And thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you, Mr. Hargrove. Anybody else on that row? Yes, sir. Come forward. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm R.C. Isley. Gentlemen and lady, for the life of me, I don't quite understand this thing. I live 1,000 feet off of the road. I just gave the state a right-of-way and 100 feet of my land to make a cul-de-sac. And my driveway's 1,000 feet off the road. And if I have a child or children that want to build it back there, I would certainly hope that they could use the same driveway. I built the driveway down, across the pine dam, and on to my house. And I would hope they could use the same road. And this doesn't sound like, if they build in the future, it doesn't sound like they could do that. And that's my main concern. It just seems like that the poor property owners get ripped in all kinds of ways. Now, if we were in town on a lot of something, I could understand it. You couldn't build any more anyway. But out on the farms, we do have tendencies to give the children places to build and et cetera. And I just don't see any sense in them spending lots of money building other roads. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Asley. How about the last row where Eddie is?
Hello again. Only thing I'll say, I can't outdo Henry much, but private is supposed to mean private in this country. If I had wanted to live in Orange County, I wouldn't have been up here 2 years fighting and fussing with y'all to stay in Alamance County. And I agree with them. This planning board has got us here to zoning. And if they have their way, we're going to start looking like Kerry one of these days. So, thank you.
I don't think that happened.
Thank you, Eddie. Okay, how about I'm sorry. Come forward. Welcome to you.
Commissioner Manning, Mr. Massey, Commissioner Sutton, Commissioner Lassley, Commissioner Boswell. Commissioner Sutton and Commissioner Lassley know me for many years from dealing with a private road.
That's right. Can you introduce yourself to the rest of us?
I'm sorry. I'm Eric Richardson. I'm on the planning board. And I missed our emergency meeting because I had other plans already made when Jason called me and said we were going to have an emergency meeting. I lived on one of these for 20 years. I'd never again live on a private road in the state of North Carolina, ever. You couldn't give me one. One of the reasons why? Because can't borrow any money against it. Can't borrow any money against it. I understand your position as a farmer. My father worked for Southern States for 40 years, cut off a piece of land to give it to the kids and the grandkids. Part of that is you're giving them something as a nest egg. Something's worth something. But if you can't borrow money against it, build it.
Well, again,
the road's a lot like the one you lived on.
Well,
it's all screwed up from the day one.
Right, but
not the same.
Right, but you're getting to a point where the banks and the insurance companies, because the General Assembly changed the law last year, because the DOT now can say to people who are in these grandfathered positions, in these private roads, or in these roads that have sufficient number of houses to qualify for inclusion in the state maintenance system, wait a second. That occurred before this drop-dead date. You get to go to the county and ask the county, even if, according to what my contacts at the DOT said, even if our county chooses not to do roads. So we're introducing a situation where you got two levels of government going to be pointing at each other. And as a taxpayer, you're not going to get anything done. Not going to get anything done. If we were to put an exception in for love and consideration as an exemption, so anybody that wanted to transfer it to children or grandchildren, you can do it. It's an exception. But if you're going to sell these on the market, you want to be able to have legitimate banking interest, mortgages, and insurance on it, because the title insurance companies are concerned about this as well, because there are problems with these road maintenance agreements in this county. We have a number of subdivisions that were done in the 90s and the early 2000s that when the economy changed in 2008, you drive down there and they're junkyards. So who's going to maintain those roads? Because one day it'll be sold on the courthouse steps, as is where is. Does that original road maintenance go with the as is where is? Something the General Assembly should take up, but not that I think that our representatives from Raleigh have enough guts to do this one. But this is one of the things that if I'd have been at the meeting, I'd have said, look, I really think we should go with a tighter restriction on if you're doing this for commercial development. If you're doing it for love and consideration, you should qualify for an exception. You should qualify, no question.
Right.
And that's handled in the deed. If you say it in the deed, it's going to your... You're paying a dollar so you can record it.
Yeah.
Right. It's automatically exempt. And that would satisfy, I would hope that would satisfy that concern. On the other side, if you got people coming in from outside who are buying, they think they're getting adequate representation with the lawyer here who's doing the title search. You know as well, you know what I mean. Can you trust that title search? So this is a layer of protection that if we're coming out of an economic downturn and looking towards the future, what we can say to our economic development recruiters is we conform to where the state leaves off. And I would question why we would want to leave that gap in between, because that would make us a top-level recruit possibility for industry in this county. Because we are a commuter community now, and so we can help attract businesses to the area around us. If we can say there is no slippage between what Raleigh requires and what Graham requires. So as a bank, as an insurance company, you are protected. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Richards. Anybody on Jennifer's row?
I do have a question.
Come forward, please. Okay. Welcome to you.
My name is Treva Gurner, and I live on Belmont Alamance Road in Burlington, but the question that I have is in reference to my mother's property, which is on South Jim Minor Road. My mother is 87 years old. She owns 11.84 acres, and she would like to divide the land while she's living among her children. But I have talked with not Jason, but Jessica at the planning department several times, Jessica Hill. And basically, my mother's land is landlocked. There is no access to a state-maintained road. Her driveway goes through a private road that is owned by a neighbor, and we do not have an easement through that land. Okay, so Jessica had told me in the past that my mother cannot divide her land as long as she is living, only when she is dead, because the subdivision rules say that that is an exclusion if it's an active estate. So when I read 64.61 here, I wonder what that means now. The tract to be subdivided has at least a minimum 60 feet of frontage on the road. That appears to have been struck from this. Is that correct? 64.61.
Where is Jason?
On the second page here, Bill.
Yes, that has been stricken, yes. Hasn't it, Jason? 64.61, it's the third highlighted area down on the second page. It's on the third page.
64.61.
That's on the pre-existing
non-conforming private road. Okay, it is pre-existing. They've lived there for 50 years since 1961, and the road was in existence probably 50 years before that. Mm-hmm.
Well, I would say that...
But she does not abut a state-maintained road. She is landlocked.
But the private road that's leading back to it is a pre-existing...
Yes, it has been for many years, yes.
The standard will still be 60 feet for private roads. That's referenced elsewhere in the ordinance. That's for just lot dimensions in general. Mm-hmm. In this case, the subdivider would be requesting a waiver from the subdivision ordinance to be able to cut out the lot. That would just be adding something additional to the waiver. That could be requested at the same time.
So we could request a waiver and go ahead and split our lots now.
Yeah, I mean, it could be done stating that...
Well, it would be a hardship to try to get a road in. I do own a lot off of another road, but it would cost $40,000 to get a driveway in there because you got briars and brambles and the hills and the streams and everything that you've got to cross.
Yeah, I mean, even today, you can request a waiver. That is an option in the subdivision ordinance, even right now. The only thing is when you request a waiver for something like that, it has to be a hardship due to something unique to the property. It can't be a financial hardship. Under different laws that governs that, it has to be something unique to the property, topography, that kind of thing.
But we could talk about,
yeah,
you know, bring a survey in or whatever.
I would be glad to do that.
Is there a limit of just four lots there that she could divide? It's really five and possibly six for her heirs. This is not to be developed. It's like these gentlemen were talking about. It's family.
I would really need to look at it without having the map in front of me and look at it. I would be doing you a disservice to try to guess.
Okay.
I would want to look at that, and I would also like to know kind of what Jessica had talked about as well.
Okay, all right. Well, we've had some conversations.
Yeah.
Okay. So we could set up a meeting possibly.
Absolutely.
And get talk about it.
Yeah, right. Anytime.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else on that front row? About the second row? About the third row? Welcome.
All right, Todd. My name is Todd Lambert. I'm a member on the Alamance County Planning Board, and I just wanted to clarify some of our viewpoints from listening to other people talk tonight. And I'm not sure that some of the general, with all due respect, I'm not sure that everybody understands what we're proposing here. In Mr. Vine's case, from what he described his road is an existing, pre-existing, non-conforming private road. The 14 does not apply to him regardless, now or in the future, under the proposed changes. The two proposed changes, as far as from the planning board standpoint, that we're looking at with the revision you have before you now is 14 to 8 lots on Class 2, and switching from the non-conforming uses or the non-conforming private roads going from one lot every 2 years now to making that a waiver process. The 14 to 8 to me keeps the people who are looking at it because they have kids and they want to cut off a lot or make a private road on their land. When you get into much more than 8 lots, to me that's not a family deal, that's a commercial development, and we need standards for that. When you're looking to sell, have people that are not related that now live on that road, there needs to be some standard, and we're looking to protect that type of development. The non-conforming going from a waiver, right now it exists that you can do one lot every 2 years. One lot every 2 years on a pre-existing private road. So if your neighbor cuts off a lot and you have a child and you come in the next week, you have to wait 2 years under the current standards. No questions asked, no waivers, no ifs, ands, or buts. Our proposal now says if you live on a pre-existing private road, as Mr. Vines described, his neighbor comes in and cuts off a lot and has his waiver. He can come in the next day and ask for 3 lots on his waiver if he has 3 children and wants to do that. I think the waiver process gives the county some means to ensure that road is there. Someone's not coming in and saying, I want to cut off 3 lots and there's no way to get there. The county can look at it and say, yes, it's there, no problems. The county can look at it and say, it's there, but you got a 50-foot gap that it's through the woods and there's no road there. Finish that road and we'll give you your waiver. It's some give and take to give the county some protection as that too. But I'm not sure the cases that they're arguing really apply for all the cases that we're proposing. The other changes are really clarifications dealing with corner lots where it talks about an interior road versus your major road. That's a corner lot. If you build a subdivision that comes off of any existing road, it's a main road, I want to design a road that comes off Highway 87. It just says that the first lot on the corner, the driveway comes off the new road, not off the main road. That's what that clarifies. Mm-hmm. It's not trying to limit anything. It's just saying don't put the driveway on 87 on the corner. You know, bring it off of the new road. And the same deal with flag lights. It just clarifies that when you're on these busy arterial roads, now you could have, if you can envision it, you could have a flag light that's back-to-back and then two lights in between them. So you could potentially end up with four driveways within 100 feet. We're trying to avoid that, too. So these are the little clarifications. To us, the two major points were the 14 to 8 lots, which we felt 8 lots still allowed families to do what they were wanting to do. You get over 8 lots, we consider that more of a commercial development type thing that we were trying to rein in the regulations on, to give protection to everybody. The nonconforming, I actually think that helps the people that live on those roads now and doesn't limit them by the 2-year process. And again, if you have any questions of me or any of the planning board members, we'd be happy to address those.
I'd just like to note to our commissioners, Todd is an engineer, and he works with doing subdivision roads and DOT every day. So we're very fortunate to have Todd on our board. Sure. To kind of help us understand some of this, because sometimes it's over my head, too. So. Todd is very good about that.
Let me ask you a couple of examples. You know, this is a thing driven totally by roads, it appears. Number one, I don't understand why we didn't have some pictures shown of what a Class 1 was and Class 2 put up here on the board for us, number one. Number two, you're out there at Altman Hall area, right? Yeah. You're familiar. Who's familiar with Altman Hall? Well, on the plane. Anybody? You know Claude Simpson Road by chance? You do know what? Okay, before they paved, my father was born on that road, and my granddaddy had a farm on that road, and my great-grandfather was down that way. Before they paved that road, was that a Class 1? Anybody know?
It had to be, in order for the state to pave it, it had to be a Class 1 road. That's what the rules are.
So it was Class 1 before they paved.
Right.
Okay. Can two cars pass each other?
Class 2.
Todd, maybe.
Okay, yeah, the difference between a Class 1 and a Class 2 is, as a Class 1, you will have 10 feet of gravel. That's all that's required. A Class 2 road will have 18 foot of gravel, but neither are required to have asphalt on them.
Okay, all right.
So the Class 1, we're saying, as it was always the case, serves 4 lots. And that's kind of small, looking at family-type developments. I've got a couple of kids. I want to have them, but, you know, we're not looking at selling.
I'm just trying to get a picture of my mind of a Class 1 versus a Class 2.
So a Class 1 is a 10-foot gravel driveway. A Class 2 would be 18 feet wide of gravel. A Class 2.
Four on each side.
Yeah, a Class 2 is just going to, it's going to be a subdivision road without asphalt. A Class 1 is going to be 10 feet wide, and again, it will be serving up to 4 lots the same way it does now is the same way we're proposing. Nothing's changing with those.
Can two cars pass each other on Class 1?
No.
Not in the gravel. If they have sufficient shoulders, one's going to have to move over on the shoulder and someone get around. But, you know, at 10 feet wide, two cars are not going to pass each other and stay on the gravel.
Well, still run. Now, I know that's paved, but still run out here in Graham. You familiar with that? Anybody familiar with that? Yeah. Now, you got to pull off the road when a car comes up. It's paved. It could very well not be paved. But you got to literally go over into the grass, and they got $200,000 homes down that road. more than 14, I think.
What is a road that's...
Do what?
Carson Pass, and it's got 8 inches of rock. What is that considered a... What level is that?
That would be a Class 2.
Class 2, okay.
It's built in DOT.
Two cars can pass when it's first built. Yeah,
that's what has to be done for the state to take over that road and pave it. Is that correct?
Class 2?
At least, yes.
Okay, at least, okay.
What is a Class 2 connected?
Well, a Class 2, this either one, a Class 1 or Class 2, under the current rules and the new rules, will have to connect to a public road. The county, our current ordinances do not allow for private roads to come off of private roads unless they're pre-existing, and then none of this really applies anyway. That's a whole different set of rules. So under the current ordinance and the proposed changes, any private road must connect to a public road.
So you could,
without a waiver, you cannot have a private road that comes off of a new private road in a subdivision.
So you could connect another private road into that private road to get 8 more lots off your farm.
Now
that will be a connecting road.
Not without a subdivision waiver.
It would have to go through a way.
And that's now, that's now and with the proposed changes. You cannot do that now.
Todd, you said there is no, on this road, I can have more than 14, I can have more than 14 on it.
From, I'm not familiar with your road, but from what you described
here, it's a 30-foot right
if it's 30 feet and was here prior to the thing, there's no cap on the limit of roads, on the number of lots you could do now, nor under the proposal. The only thing the proposal would do was allow you, you would have to get a waiver, but you could do more than one every 2 years.
Sell it.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that was... That's not the way it was presented.
But that was your concern.
Yeah, and that's why I wanted to speak, because, like I said, it's not being disrespectful, but what you argued wasn't what our proposal was to the commissioners.
But though you're trying to do safety for the public, correct? But yet you're allowing, you want to allow waivers. If it's not to be done, if it's not good to be done, period, why should there be any waivers made? If this is all done in the best interest and safety of the community, I mean, it's a matter of who you come up here, who you know and what you know, of what you're going to get a waiver or not.
Well, from the planning board standpoint, the waivers on, there's two issues. There's the pre-existing non-conforming, and that's completely separate than a new development. In your case, the waiver would kind of dictate a process that's allowed more reasonable than what you can do now.
But for future, I'm sorry to interrupt, but for future developments, there would be a limitation, is that right? There would be a cap.
If you were doing private roads, it's limited at 14 lots now. We proposed 8 lots because our planning board and the other members can correct me if I'm misspeaking for them. The consensus was you get much more than that and it becomes a commercial development, not a family tract of land that you're trying to do something for your kids.
Wasn't this said that 14 was the limit that should be recommended for a private development versus going on to, a large development? I don't understand why it would make any difference for 6 more cars coming out that road versus 8. And that would give an individual right to put 14 on there without going and conforming to a big development that would be 40 or 50 or 60. But if you build this road in accordance to what you're saying, the state will take it over anyway.
Well,
I'm just going to inject, the state ain't going to take over no roads. Yes. They don't want the responsibility.
They want you as a landowner.
Yeah, and that's why I used the comment that was the minimum that the state would be 18 foot wide. If you go to the state tomorrow and say, I have an 18-foot gravel road, will you take it over? They're going to come out there. They're going to give you this long list of inspections to say, when you do 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 and bring it up to what we want, we'll take it over.
Right.
And that's going to include making sure that it's truly 18-foot wide everywhere, that you have standard ditches, that all your crossings are the properly sized pipe, that in this day and age, that you're going to pave it before they take it over to start with. That's kind of a separate animal altogether than this ordinance is anyway, on when you get to what qualifies for state maintenance.
State is not going to take any roads.
Well, actually, if they were built to DOT standards by Todd Brew, our subdivision, and they're getting ready to take over roads.
If you can afford to do it, they're going to take it over.
Right, but DOT standards is going to include paving anyway. Right.
Housing on a road,
mm-hmm.
10 foot, right?
Correct.
From 5 to 8 goes to 18 feet, is
yes.
that right?
Yes.
My name is Mark.
And that's the only difference between that and what it is now is it's 5 to 14 is 18 foot wide. If you do 5 lots now, it's still going to be 18 foot wide.
Okay. I was just going to say, economically speaking, we all want jobs coming to the area. When you limit the supply of anything, the price goes up. So my thoughts are the price of real estate in general with this will cause this to go up just simply on the basis of the law of supply and demand. If you're going to limit, drop it from 14 to 80, to me that's what bothers me the most.
Question. Are we going to go out here and hire inspectors to run all over the county to check these things?
No more than we do now, because that's not changing under the proposal versus what's existing.
But we've got enough inspectors now.
Yeah, I mean, the level of inspection for the roads doesn't change. The only wording that clarified inspections was clarifying that if you don't want Jason to go look at it, you can hire someone else to look at it. But that's the case now. It's just not in writing. That doesn't change. That just kind of clarifies it. But it doesn't say that you have to hire somebody to look at it. You can call Jason and ask him to look. I mean, that's always the case, and it just clarifies that. It's not changing or putting a new restriction or requirement on someone.
I got a question.
Sir,
I agree with
you. Yeah, just step up here, will you? Thank you for your assistance there. And I think maybe Jason may want to come back before we move forward.
My name's Charles Anka, live on Swetsonville Road down here. My question is, I understand a lot of what he's saying about trying to keep, you know, like me, if I wanted to take my land and just say I'm going to do these lots. But he's my nephew, my sister's boy, and we had a big family at one time, and he's got kids. I got two kids. And he's wanting to restrict it to 5. If we give all our kids, he's got 2 kids, I got kids, they're old enough to start having kids. I mean, we might want to give our grandkids lots, and you're going to cut it to 5. Well, we couldn't afford to put these kind of driveways in for, you know, I ain't saying it could be 12 or 15. And he's saying it's going to commercial, it ain't really commercial. It's a farm that's been in my family since the 1800s. I mean, there'll be some considerations for some things. I understand you don't want to understand both sides of it, but there'll be some considerations for people that's been here a long time, families and
passing
stuff, I think.
Passing through to the family, which right. is what Eric was saying. I think we might do that.
Thank you for the time.
Thank you.
Thank you. If I can just make one more point.
Well, on the, quickly.
Okay, quickly.
quickly.
Moving from 14 to 8, and then we're building the roads to conform. It has to be more economical if you can build and put 14 lots on that road versus 8. And this is a private road that I may want to build, or Gordon might want to build. He's got 100 and some acres over there. He might want to just put in there and put that road in for his grandchildren, his children, his aunts, his uncles, whatever. It would be more economical if you could put 14 on that road and not go past that amount instead of 8. I mean, you know, it to me, to an individual, you know, at least we would be able to utilize more of our land with the amount of money that we're being asked to be spent on this road. So I just firmly believe that moving it from 14 to 8 should not be done. I mean, we have clear rules and guidelines from the state that governs the amount on a development when it moves into a commercial.
Okay, thank you, Henry. Okay. Yeah. I don't want to keep going around in a circle. Well, quickly, because both of you have already spoken.
It's something here, I can write, because we've got roads now. I don't understand all the technicalities they're talking about, but we got roads right now. You can't get down with anything short of an Amtrak or something. And so something is going on here. In other words, they're not enforcing and making people put the gravel in there and take care of what they got now.
That's
so
why
something has got to be going on here that I'm not catching, because why make a more strict and more rule when what they got now is still you can't drive down? Something ain't right here.
That's why they call this private roads, I think.
Mark, you have a final comment?
I was just wondering if there were actual examples of where, were there examples of, you know, situations like you described, like somebody couldn't get the ambulance to their house and they died, or, you know, something like that. Was that what brought this on? I mean, what brought this up?
Jason, maybe Jason can speak to that, because there have been roads in the past that the citizens did not understand why county or the state wasn't taking care of the roads, but they bought lots on private roads and thought that this would be maintained by county or state, and maybe Jason can address that.
Well, there's definitely examples of all of these different types of private roads in the county. The one that kind of comes to mind, just going ahead and calling it by name, is Horner Farm Trail, which is off of Mebane Oaks Road, I believe. Horner Farm Trail is a pre-existing non-conforming private road. There were lots cut off of that, I believe as recent as 1998, that were cut off of that, allowing additional houses to be put back there. That particular road, that was an example I gave when I did the presentation at the first meeting in February. There was a picture that I had on the screen of a
big pothole,
of a giant pothole there, and everything was there was plastic that was run underneath the pipe underneath it that was crushed in, water everywhere, and that was probably the best part of the road. I'll say it that way. As you go back, I don't know that there's that much gravel on it. Is basically a mud road. That's one example that I can think of.
I'm going to interrupt you a second. On that road, and as you went back to the back, these are individuals, not all part of one family on this road. Is that correct?
That I don't know. They may all very well be family that have lots back there. That I don't know. That is one example. The mountain trail is another example, which that, of course, is now a state-maintained road, mountain trail is, and it's, I believe, been paved.
Talking about
Fire Tower. Fire Tower Road is another good example.
You're not kidding.
that is another very good example of a private road. I believe that is another non-conforming,
yes.
Pre-existing non-conforming private road.
Who in the world would buy a lot of land or a house or anything unless you had some type of...
Well, in the past, they have.
I just can't understand
it. Well,
that's what part of this is.
I actually showed a house on Fire Tower Road, and when I come out, they said, get me out of here.
I don't blame them.
And I know Cucumber Branch is another, and that's getting into another issue where those appear to be publicly dedicated, but it's not real clear if they're publicly dedicated, at private roads as well. All of those are examples where we've had citizens call and want to have it taken over by a public agency. They want the county to take it over. They want the state to take it over. There are folks that are there. And I think the issue is not so much when you have family development that to start with, it's the next down the line where somebody moves out and somebody that's not family comes in and they don't know the history of what is on that road. Those are three good examples right off the top of my head. Class 2 private roads. Tobacco Road is an example of a Class 2 private road. That one, I believe, is already maxed out at 14 lots going back. There's another class. There's a few Class 1 private roads. Another one off of Snow Camp Road has the picket fence.
Justin, there's a sunset down there, too, somewhere.
Sunset. Yes, that's another private road.
That's another private road that's got ditches in it like this.
Right. And, go back to just kind of one of the comments that was made about the maintenance of the roads. That's part of the issue. The county, it's a private road. The county cannot force maintenance of a private road. We can put stipulations on further development of the private road, additional cutting of lots. And one other point that nobody has really brought up, and it's something that I didn't bring up before, is that we do not have a restriction on the number of houses that can be on a lot. So technically, there can be multiple driveways coming off of a lot to that private road.
Of course, in the county, the health department is going to determine a lot of
that. Right, that's exactly right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, there's yeah. still the possibilities there. And one other point too is I do appreciate the comments that we've received and the comments we've received here tonight. I sincerely do, and I know my board does as well. The planning department takes a lot of pride in when somebody wants to develop their land coming to us and saying that exact example. I have a family and I have grandchildren that I want to cut out a lot. I want to cut out lots for, and I want them to be able to inherit this. And that's what Jessica and I are there for, is to try to look at your situation and not tell you what you can't do per se, but to look at it and give you options as to how you can achieve what you're trying to do. It may not necessarily be with a private road, but that's why we have other options in our ordinance, such as access easements, exclusive access easements, the non-conforming, unbuilt private road standard in there, so that we have tools to be able to work with our citizens. And that's definitely something we take a great deal of pride in, sitting down and trying to work through those issues with folks.
Thank you, Jason.
Thank you.
Okay, at this time we will close the public hearing and turn to this as an agenda item. Commissioners, comments, responses, recommendations, where do we go from here?
I would like to table this until further and get more information and reconsider it. And what I mean by that is I'm not willing to vote in favor of this tonight. I don't need any more information. If I had to vote right now, I'd vote against it. But I think there's some things can be worked out.
Other comments?
I agree with Bill's sentiment. Myself, I'm just... You know, I value our planning committee by all means, but I think the thing I take pride in is I don't rubber stamp anything that somebody tells me, whether it be the planning committee, county manager, or other commissioners. I'm embarrassed to tell you, but I want to ride down a class one road.
We can take you down one.
We should have seen pictures of this on the wall. We should have seen some of this without just guessing and so forth.
We did, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
We should have been.
And I should have ridden down a class one road already. Yeah, I'm not going to lie to you there, but I have severe reservations about, you know. I want to ask a question that sounds silly. And if I got it on my mind, it's not silly to me. You got 1 to 4, and it's class one. All right, let's say you go to 5 to 6. What happens to, years later, what happens to that class one up to that point that was up to the four?
This would not change either way as it currently stands in moving forward. They would have to upgrade the road.
The whole thing to a class two?
Yes.
For five lots?
That is correct.
Yeah, I don't agree with that at all.
You might as well give them other lots of weight, though. You wouldn't make any more money if you were selling them or whatever, or if you was giving them to your kids. Yeah. You couldn't afford to bring that road up from a 10-foot road to an 18-foot road under state specification.
Yeah. My opinion is I don't think the county government should be telling private people what they can do with their business and what they should do with their roads and how to build the roads on their private property. You know, as long as they're safe, I think it's nobody's business.
Okay, if we table this, we don't really need a motion. We need consensus to table it with the understanding that, Bill, it would go back to the planning board for further review and input.
I don't care if it ever comes back. I'm just in favor of tabling
it. Table it forever.
Table it forever. That's
well,
right. it's working good for
Tom. I want to make a couple of comments to it because the planning board did work hard, and there are some things in here I think that have been made in addition to that will help people in the future that maybe are going to buy one of these lots mm-hmm. from one of these individuals wanting to give it all to the family, but things didn't work out. They decided to sell half of them, you know.
these people need to know that that road they're moving in on, what it is.
Private road.
And part of this thing said in 64-2 that it will be on the plat, that it is on a private road, and they will understand that. And you being a banker, I'm sure you want to know that too, what kind of road this property is on. I think that's very important. From what I heard, really the sticking point was the 8 to 14 was the main change we're talking about that everybody was concerned about. My question to our attorney is, can we put a pass-through clause into this amendment somewhere that if these people that own all this land want to give it to all their relatives, I'm not related to them, but were it'd be nice. But anyhow, can we put that kind of clause into this?
Make any amendment you want to.
Because from what I'm hearing,
but it
I
doesn't
think
have to be now. Part of this. We can table this and still solve this problem without going to all this additional cost.
Well, it'd have to go somewhere. I mean, it has to be stated.
Jason can have it. Well, I think the people need to go to the meeting.
Right.
Because evidently they didn't go to this last meeting that you guys had. They were not there. So that's why it's coming back, because we thought we were going to have it all fixed tonight. But evidently, you know, they didn't know that this was coming up until now. Is that not right?
Well, Harold showed up at the meeting, and he had some good comments to make, and I understand that.
But I think that they need to go and talk with the planning board, because we, you know, I know what a Class 1 road is. I can tell you.
I know what a Class 1 road is.
I lived on one for a long time.
I mean, out of the whole thing they've done, really, that's the biggest catching point from what I've heard. Mm-hmm. From everybody that's come up before the board tonight. So I'm okay with tabling. I think we do need to address it, because there's some waiver stuff that has been implemented in here that people do need.
What protection is there if a developer came along and wanted to buy the land and develop it? Now, he would have to build a class.
Would he?
He's going to do it anyway, because he wouldn't be able to sell them if he did.
Right.
Clyde, is this something we need a motion for, or can we do it by consensus?
I'd have a motion.
All right, Bill?
I'll make the motion. We table this.
Is there a second from Eddie? Any other discussion? Well, I think what we're doing is referring it back. No, we're referring it back.
Well, if you table it, it can always be brought back up. Well,
I would say after the next planning board.
It has to be a consensus to bring it out of the table.
No, I don't mind tabling it. I just don't want to table it forever.
Well,
I think it needs to be tabled until the planning board and then can get together.
Definition for tabling. It's all five of us has to agree to bring it back up, right?
Let's move to consideration. If you wanted to vote on it now and you didn't have a majority, then you could bring it up within 100 days. Anybody could bring
it up.
Is that
fair?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, but not forever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It can be brought up within 100 days.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any other comments? And the motion is to table this item, basically put it back in your hands, the understanding that within 100 days it can be brought back for further consideration.
Okay.
A motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And thank you all for coming tonight, the folks that were participants in the public hearing. If you do have further questions, I would suggest you meet with Jason outside.
All I know is if you do bring it back up, will the public?
Yes.
Oh, absolutely.
It certainly will. Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now
it has to be. What is it, 40 hours?
You have to have notice of public hearings.
Okay,
notice of public hearings. It'd be a repeat of the process we went through tonight.
We will put it on the agenda for the public hearing.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I can say that this would probably, it will not go at the March meeting, which was scheduled for Thursday. That meeting's actually been canceled for the planning board, but it will go at the April meeting.
Okay. All right, and how do these gentlemen know that the planning board, where will they see the notice?
The planning board is not something that we actually advertise in the paper. We have a set meeting schedule,
need to call your office and find out.
Yes.
So they can all do that?
Give them the date and they can go ahead and put
absolutely.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Jason,
yes.
Give them the date that it will be held.
I'll be glad to do that.
Safe in April.
Yep.
Okay. Well, thank you. And thank you for that dialogue and that discussion. Okay, we are going to move on to item 7, which are two budget amendments, one from the Department of Social Services, one for the emergency telephone system. Representing the Department of Social Services tonight is Susan Osborne.
Good evening.
Good evening. Hold on 1 second, please.
Sure.
Mr. Chair, we need to also go back into the consent.
No, it's approved as part of the agenda.
Both the things pulled out.
Two items.
Oh, yeah. I've got that. That's going to be after item number 8.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
I thought you meant we had approved the consent agenda.
I'm sorry. My fault.
Good evening.
Good evening. I have a budget amendment. A couple times a year, we try to catch up our budget to the actual allocations. We get estimates at the first of the year. This budget amendment contains a lot of energy money. The total, after you look at the pluses and the minuses, and it's an additional $1.381 million. Most of it goes to energy and our LEAP programs, and about $200,000 in daycare funds, some Smart Start funds, and some subsidy funds, which helps our waiting list because we have about 600 kids on our daycare waiting list. So we're serving more children in subsidized daycare. And the rest is energy assistance. We have exhausted most of our LEAP funds, but still have SIP funds to help community residents with their power bills.
And Susan, where does this money actually come from? Because the county gets a pass-through, is it not?
Yes, it is. It's state and federal.
State and federal.
State and federal.
Any questions for Susan? Is there a motion to approve this amendment?
I'll second it.
Thank you. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
You opposed?
No.
Craig, I have one question. When we do the budget, and I know we're going to start in April, I've had a lot of people ask me, what do we really do versus what's passed through? And I would like to see in the budget process the money that truly is coming from Alamance County versus what the pass-through funds are.
Yes,
I think it makes a big difference in the piece of the pie that goes where.
Well, in this $1 million, the majority of it is pass-through funds. And I'll be glad in the future to mark our budget amendments that way as well.
Well, I don't know that you needed that on my account, but I would like to at least look in the budget process, because when we see our total county budget of X, it's really not X.
Right.
That's the
money that we're responsible for passing through. Okay, are you also going to be looking
not mine.
Okay, you're. Thank you, Susan.
I'm going to take Dexter's place tonight. With the board's permission, a budget amendment for $65,000 to transfer from our E911 funds to run fiber from the HSC building, Fire Marshal's office, and Eastside EMS base back to the county office building and over to Graham Municipal Building. Frank Merricks is here. Frank can give you the details and the specifics and why we feel like that this is a better option to run the fiber.
Hey, Frank, Eddie. Come forward.
Yes, yeah.
What did you say?
Eddie's.
Come forward.
Running satellite.
I wasn't expecting to speak tonight, otherwise, I
wouldn't
be
here. We don't care.
But Dexter's not asking for something new or in addition to what he's doing now. He's asking for something that's to do in a different way. Right now, he buys and purchases most of his telco services from AT&T now. It used to be Bell South. There's a monthly charge associated with that. All right. He wants to convert from what they're doing now, and what they're doing now, there's two cabinets as tall as I am, plumb full of equipment that'll run the 911 system. He's trying to move to what's called a voice over IP system, which gives him a whole lot more functionality, a whole lot more speed, and mobility. And by that, what I mean is he can literally take these CAD stations and take them to anywhere he can get a high-speed internet connection and set up dispatching. Say, if we'd have been caught in one of those tornadoes and this building was gone, he could take a few stations and he could go over to the fire marshal's office and run dispatching. He could do the same thing at the city of Burlington. He could do it at DSS because we'd have a connection there. To anywhere we can set up space and get an internet connection, they can actually dispatch from anywhere in the county. I understand what Mr. Shue says, but right now we're paying AT&T large amounts of money. Dexter's ROI on this is 3 to 5 years. And after that, fiber's ours. We own it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Frank.
Let's give Frank that information.
Frank is aware of
this. This is Eddie Shue's proposal for
Your consideration.
Well, I understand what he says.
But you're talking about POTS lines, plain old telephone service, what everybody's always had for years. You pick up your phone, you get dial tone. How many of you have now got your cell phones from Verizon Wireless or Time Warner? Your phone calls are being routed over the internet. You're doing voice over IP at your house. He's talking about doing it on the 911 county level, and he'll actually end up saving money. His monthly cost will be less once we go to this as a transition than what he's doing now, and a whole lot more reliable.
It's important to have more than one
to communicate.
Because, I mean, you know, anybody can have a tornado.
Sure.
They could have taken out this building and the fire marshal's office. Then we could have gone to the city of Burlington and set up, or DSS.
Now, is this a bid process that went on to get this?
The pricing for the fiber, yes, sir.
Okay.
Competitive bidding. But it, like I said, it's not new. It's a different way of doing things, and the county's going to actually save money in the long run. His ROI is 3 to 5 years, from what I remember him saying.
Is that's what you're saying? That's a return on the on
After that, the fiber's free. It's ours. We do what we want to with it. And you're actually running, and I don't want to get too technical, but you're actually running 12 pair of fiber. With one pair, we could actually have disaster recovery between this building and DSS. So functionally, we can use other pairs to do other functions, and it's still our fiber. I'm paying a monthly charge, Bell South, to have a 45 meg pipe from here to HSC. It's costing me a good deal of money each month.
It'll be ours.
I can drop it.
We can drop that. Okay.
Any other questions for Frank or for Greg on this issue? Is there a motion?
It's coming from the emergency fund.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And the state's already approved it. State approved it because it's a good option. That's the way all the counties in the state are going. In fact, that's the way most people are going in their home. It's cheaper, you know. A phone line from AT&T, a regular old POTS line, they were charging $35, $40 a month. If I remember my bill, you can get it from AT&T, and I mean not AT&T, but Verizon over DSL or Time Warner over cable for $25 a month. Who's not going to do it? So it's economy, functionality, and mobility.
I think it makes sense because it'll pay for itself in 3 years.
What a good return on our money.
I make a motion that we...
I'll second that motion.
Thank you, Eddie. Bill, any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, online permitting update, item number 8. I see Bob coming forward. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Good evening.
Hey, you all. As you recall, last fall I was before you to both introduce you to our proposed online permitting program and to sort of demonstrate how we envision it to work. We also had planned on rolling it out before the end of the year. Unfortunately, we hit a couple of snags and we had to take a couple steps backward. But our MIS team, Frank's team, worked real hard to overcome those obstacles. And last month we were able to field test the whole operation and work out the final bugs. And I'm standing here before you to happily announce that as of last Thursday, we're open for business. We're up online and working well. And we've had a couple of contractors already obtain permits online. So,
how are you getting the word out to let people know its availability online?
We have it both. We have it on our website, and it's spreading out through the construction community. When they buy the permits, it's being spread out through the industry.
Well, good. Well, congratulations.
I'm hearing some good reports on that.
Thank you. I like to publicly thank the MIS crew for doing it. I mean, it was an MIS project. They worked real hard to do it, and kudos to them, especially Doug Bennett and Stephen Massey, who worked directly with me on it. They worked really hard on the project, and thank you all for supporting it.
I know this has been something going on for, I know when Sammy was there, he was talking about we're going to do this, but it's really nice.
Well, it should be beneficial to our citizens and to the the contractors in the county.
Right. Very much so.
And most of the other surrounding counties are.
And going forward, we intend to tweak it, perhaps add some more permitting applications online as well. So we'll continue to move forward with it.
It's certainly a step in the right direction.
Yeah, it's good to hear a success story.
All your work.
Bob, I was going to ask him one question. How is the interlocal working with the other municipalities working? Have you done any of those? Or
we really
how
haven't, not yet. Hasn't come up yet. But,
okay, just curious to see where I had some contractors asking about it, but just wasn't really sure.
I guess no one's had the...
Everybody's staffed pretty well right now.
We haven't had the option. Okay.
Very good. Bob, thank you. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Bob.
Before we move to the next item, we did approve under the consent part the trip that the fire marshal is going to take, and I would like to just read as a congratulatory note of what the fire marshal is going to do. Again, this has been approved, and I meant to say it when we were looking at that, but Dave Leonard is going to be traveling to a National Emergency Training Center conference. It's in Maryland. It's a couple of days in March. And this was requested by actually the county manager from Moore County, and it's a result of Dave Leonard participating in some of the work as a result of Hurricane Irene in Hyde County. And this gentleman is the deputy director in Moore County of the Department of Public Safety. The quote is, "I personally worked closely with David during this deployment. He demonstrated a superior knowledge for EOC operations, critical incident response to major disasters, and the overall importance of working relationships with numerous other partner agencies during a major incident." So this is an honor and a recognition that Dave's receiving. And if you see him, you might want to congratulate him. They're completely paying for it. The only thing we're losing out on is his time while he's away. So it's a good piece of news there, in my opinion. Okay. We pulled off the out-of-state travel request from the Family Justice Center, two different items. And here from the Family Justice System Center is Cindy Brady, the director. Welcome.
Thank you. So do you want me to present? You've got questions. On the travel to Apparis to Kentucky for the electronic 50B system, I thought that we would tell them what we wanted, and they would say, yes, we'll do that, and then that's it. But it does not work that way. And I guess I liken it a lot like the courthouse, where you have meetings and meetings and meetings, and you have to touch base, and you have to make sure you're all on the same page. And so we've done a lot of that by conference calling, but there are just a couple of issues that have come up, and they've asked for a part of the group to come back because they are building that software system in Kentucky and to consult with them again.
Cindy, you might want to just quickly discuss and define what the electronic 50B system is and what it will do compared to what we're doing now.
So right now, when a victim comes to get a protective order at the even at the Family Justice Center, we provide a lot of services there, but they still have to go five places. So they have to leave the building, go to the clerk of court's office, go to the courthouse, go back to the clerk of court's office, and actually they get the order to the sheriff. So the victim now does not have to go to the sheriff's department, but they have to go four places. Once the electronic filing is in, the victim will come to the Family Justice Center. Everything is automated and will be done on the web. The teleconferencing with the judge will be done from the Family Justice Center, and everything's going to happen automatically. The victim will not have to leave the building.
Good.
In addition to that, she'll receive notifications about when the order's been served, you know, when her court date's coming up, when the order expires.
And the order is typically what, again, just to get basic definitions?
It's a temporary protective order to protect the victim from the defendant and to make sure he has no contact with them.
And you're using she and he, but it's really, it could be he and she.
It could be he and she, 20%. Mm-hmm. It is mostly female, but it could be either gender.
Okay, board members, you want to take these two items separately?
Yeah, I want to ask a question. The OVC,
OVW.
Yeah, OVW.
Office of Violence Against Women.
Okay, grant, that's a federal grant.
It is.
Here's my problem. I'm in favor of doing what we need to do. You know, I'm opposed to excessive grants, and I'm opposed to the mentality of taking it because, number one, somebody else will get it. We always take that. And number two, not being bold enough to say, well, we don't need all that grant.
Mm-hmm.
We can still. I don't have a problem with you going to Kentucky, but I have a problem with four people going to New Orleans for four mm-hmm. nights.
Well, can we address that one separately?
Yeah, it's fine with me. Because I'll support one, but I can't vote for the other one. Just do that. I think it's excessive. And in all honesty, our country is literally, we're bankrupt. And somebody has got to finally say, no. And if it has to start at the local level, I just believe that some of our grants that we're accepting here and we're using here, utilizing here, are excessive and could we should be able to do the work that needs to be done at a much cheaper price. So, and I know that it looks like I'm anti what you're doing. I'm not. It's just I support you going where you're going and you going even to New Orleans. But I have a problem with four people going to New Orleans for four nights.
And I'll talk a little bit about that. But
thank you, Tim. Are there other comments or questions about the trip to, is it Louisville in Kentucky? Is that where you're going?
Yes. Back to
questions
Louisville.
About the Louisville trip.
Louisville.
I think this is great, the beat, doing the 50 Bs and getting that, doing electronic. And I think it's good to be on the edge of learning mm-hmm. on that. So I have no problem with that. And we'll talk about the other one in a minute.
Okay. Any other questions about the Louisville trip?
I want to make a comment, yeah. I think this is part of the purpose of the Family Justice Center
mm-hmm.
Is to have the 50 be there so that these people will not have to go to five different places. If we cut it to four, then maybe next time we can cut it to three. And whatever it takes, I think that's what we need to do because that is the purpose. And we have like, what, five different places they have to go to mm-hmm. now. So that's the purpose of the Family Justice Center because if we don't do what we have to do to get accredited or whatever we have to do, then there's no reason for us to have the Family Justice Center because that's what we all did it for.
That's right.
And the electronic 50Bs
exactly
were original part of it. That's
right. It's a key part of it.
And I think if we don't do what we should do to get them what they should have at the Family Justice Center, why did we take it?
Right.
Well, my point is they check no on both forms. It's not necessary for accreditation, number one. Number two, I'm not opposed to the 50B deal. Right. I'm just saying four people. Let me ask you, four people going to New Orleans, was it required that four go?
It is not. And you know, I've been there a year now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and a lot of people say, well, just have a retreat and just have it.
Teleconference.
You know, teleconference. Just have it here. Just do that. And it works so differently than it does if Craig has everybody go to retreat. They're going to go. They work for him. And so these are volunteers for me at the end of the day. And I've talked enough teleconferencing with Family Justice Centers to know that there are lots of things that we should and need be doing to do. And I certainly could go and try to come back and communicate that. But it is so much better if the sheriff goes and talks to another sheriff, or the judge goes and talks to another judge. And I hear what you're saying, but I do know that this group is operating as a team, and a lot of that team came from them learning and experiencing this stuff together.
What judge is going? I'll see the judge on here.
Well, he's not a county employee. It's Judge Jim.
Jim Robinson.
Okay, so there's five people going?
Lynn and Lynn Russo with Family Abuse Services.
Six people going? Mm-hmm. Keeps getting higher.
Yeah. And so, let me tell you the story about what a team looks like. And it's, you still have to vote the way you, I hear you. I hear exactly what you're saying, and you have to do what you feel is right. But we had an instance where there's two kinds of protective orders, okay? There's one for domestic violence, and then there's one for non-consensual sexual contact and stalking. So I'm a data geek, and I went back and looked because the Family Justice Center was just being overrun with these 50 Cs. Out of 101 that were done between January and June of 2011, one of them was for its intended purpose. Well, this team that works as a team got together, decided amongst themselves what to change the protocol. Since they've changed it, we've had six. It has saved about 752 hours, man hours, between the county and the state. And so I guess what I'm trying to say is that when you get a group of people together that operate like that and they learn together, I can't make anybody do anything. I do not have the authority. They're volunteers for me. But when they hear about it from their counterpart somewhere else, they're more willing to do it. And I think at the end of the day, it's going to save time and money.
Was $9,000 the max that you could spend on this?
Sir?
Was $9,000 the max you could spend on this trip to New Orleans?
No. In fact, I had to get special authorization from the Office of Violence Against Women because this is a departure from them. For them, for, you know, six people to go. They usually limit it to four or five as well. But I believed in it, and so I asked, which is why I'm here tonight.
Commissioners, if we could address the first one, we'll take these in a separate vote, if that's all right with everybody. The first issue and agenda item would be the trip to Louisville, Kentucky, which would be... was that 3 days coming up in March, I believe, Cindy?
It is next week, actually.
Okay. Is there a motion on the Louisville trip?
I'll give you a motion on that one.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Linda? Yeah. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. No opposed. Now, on the trip to New Orleans, where we've got four county or county-related employees attending and... two others, is that right, Cindy? Mm-hmm. Is there a motion for that to approve that trip?
I make a motion to approve that trip.
Is there a second?
I'm going to have to be with Tim on that one, I think, because don't fall out of there, Tim. You'll be all right.
Don't kick your bucket, Tim.
Well, number one, I'm not really sure that, you know.
Is it the number?
Well, that
it's excessive. Our country is bankrupt, and what is going to happen? And I don't understand why people don't understand this in government. I swan it, I don't understand it. Our country is bankrupt, and what's going to happen when it all finally comes down? Everybody's job's going to be 3-4 times 10 times harder than it is today because we won't grab it by the you know what and say that no more. And it's just like get it, the mindset is get it while we can, spend it because it's there. That's why we are bankrupt and people just don't want to admit it. And it's just like every, I don't care what government agency it is, and I'm not fussing at you.
I know you aren't.
I hope you believe it. I mean, I hate violence.
You've been very supportive.
Yes. More than anybody. I mean, you know, anybody. I love the show on TV where the guy berates his girlfriend and everybody's watching to see if anybody's going to help. You know, that's, you know, anybody doesn't get up and help somebody, they need their head examined. But our country's just had it, and we just keep going. That's why I've opposed the grant, you know, to take 10 people to a national trip every year. And it's mandated they bring 10. If people don't understand what this is all about, you know, there's no wonder we're going to hit the dust. And you know what I'm mad at? I'm not mad at I'm mad at what my children's going to inherit. My grandson, Caleb, that he's going to inherit such a sorry scenario in America because we as leaders and department heads wouldn't say enough's enough. And, yeah, I think there's got to come a point where we say we don't want this grant or we don't want all this grant or we won't spend but $4,000 instead of $9,000. And nobody seems to want to do that. I've got to do it.
And the travel's not mandated by the grant, so I don't want anybody to get that impression.
We have a motion. However, we do not have a second, and if we do not get a second, the motion will die. For the lack of a second. So I'll say one more time, we have a motion on the floor from Ms. Massey. Is there a second?
Well, point of order on what they're requesting. Can you still do this anyway if we vote no?
I would not.
Okay. But could you?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's a county policy that we request, not with county employees. I mean, I could send Lynn and Judge Jim because it has been approved by the grant.
Okay, well, I feel like I'm an auctioneer. There's a motion, but there's no second. Therefore, the motion dies for lack of a second, and the issue is over.
Thank you, Cindy.
Okay. We now turn to county manager reports. Craig, do you have anything for us?
I do. A couple of dates just to bring to your attention. We do have a request from the Farm Bureau for our annual lunch meeting. We have three dates that they have suggested. Tuesday, March 27th, Tuesday, April 3rd, or Tuesday, April 10th.
And these are all at lunchtime, is that correct?
Yes, sir, at Iron Gate.
The only other schedule issue that we have at that same time is that evening of the 27th, we're scheduled to meet with ACC trustees.
Yes,
so
sir.
For that reason, we may want to do it that day, or we may not want to do it that day, or we may want to do it that day and just have a full day of commissioner.
I got a meeting at 8 o'clock that morning.
What's your all's feeling? Is there a preference?
Executive.
I'm teaching a class at Greensboro during that period, but it's in the afternoons into the 7 o'clock at night, so I don't know what time frame we're talking about.
Well, I think normally like 12 to 1:30 or so. Yeah. But it's in Mebane.
Yes, sir.
Out at Iron Gate. Is that?
Yeah. Okay, well, can we eliminate the, is it comfortable to eliminate the March date because of the evening commitment that we have? Is everybody all right with that?
I think we can eliminate that date.
Okay, so either look at your calendars. Well, what I would suggest is, because everybody may not have their calendar, I would ask you to ask Tori to check with everybody and see which of those other two dates might work.
April
3rd and April 10th. It's three
April
Tuesdays
3rd,
in a row.
April 3rd, April 10th.
And be lunchtime.
And that's on a Tuesday?
Yes.
Sign me up for either one of them. Either one of those days are good for me.
I think I am too. I'd have to check.
Okay. Around lunchtime, I'm available for lunch. I'm going to eat lunch somewhere. I might as well eat lunch there.
Let them buy it, right.
Okay. Other issues, Craig?
And again, we just mentioned the ACC trustees meeting, which will be also on March 27th at 6 p.m. We'll have dinner there as well. And also, please do not forget our budget retreat, which will be on April 2nd, 9:30 a.m. at May Memorial. And that will be the first presentation of the draft budget.
Do you think at that time you could separate the pass-through items? Because I think it would be helpful. I know to me, I went through the first one last year, and I'd like to see what we're really doing, not what's being channeled through us.
Yes, sir.
Okay, any other announcements from you, Craig, at this time?
That is all. Thanks.
I'd like to make a motion that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143.318.11A6 to consider the qualifications and conditions of appointment or conditions of initial employment of a public officer or employee. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Eddie. Any questions about that? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, we'll go next door.